Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the College of Brockport, State University of New York, and to the inauguration of the college's 7th president, Dr. Heidi Macpherson. Please remain standing for the presentation of the colors by the Army ROTC Color Guard and the singing of our national anthem by Brockport student Osea Miles.
Say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous flight o'er the ramparts we watch were so gallantly gleaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Thank you, Osea. That was just terrific. Please be seated. My name is Scott Turner, and as chairman of the Brockport College Council, it is my honor to serve as master of ceremonies for this auspicious event today. I would like to introduce the people joining me on the platform today. Please stand as your name is called. And please, audience, hold your applause until everyone has been introduced. Representing the Brockport Alumni Association, Warren Kowzerski. Brockport Student Government President, Sean Flynn. Representing United University Professions, Dr. Joe Torrey. Representing the Civil Service Employees Association, Mr. Ed Hoover. City of Rochester Mayor, the Honorable Lovely Warren. Village of Brockport Mayor, the Honorable Margay Blackman. State University of New York Trustee, Marshall Lishman. Representing the Brockport Foundation, Maureen Casey. Monroe County Executive, the Honorable Cheryl Donolfo. Executive Director and Dean of the Rochester Educational Opportunity Center, Roosevelt Marius. President of the Brockport College Senate, Dr. Allison Parker. Representing the academic community, Dr. Steve Klepetar. New York State Lieutenant Governor, the Honorable Kathy Hochul. The Chancellor of the State University of New York and a great friend of the College of Brockport, Dr. Nancy Zimfer. And finally, the seventh president of the College of Brockport, Dr. Heidi Macpherson. Ceremonies such as we are having here today celebrate the college and its place in its long and illustrious history of this community and this state. The continuity of this history is well represented by the presence of two former Brockport presidents who are with us today. Please join me in recognizing these great leaders, the college's fourth president, Dr. John Vander Wettering, and the college's sixth president, Dr. John Halstead. And I personally salute the two of you for your long and respected history as leaders of our college. I would also like to acknowledge the presence of several public officials or the representatives who've joined us here today. If they would stand when I call their name and remain standing, I would ask that the audience to please hold your applause until all are acknowledged. Representing the Honorable Kirsten Gillibrand, United States Senator from New York, is her regional assistant, Niombe Tomlinson. Representing the New York State Senate are the Honorable Robert Ort and the Honorable Joe Robach. Representing New York State Assemblyman Steve Hawley is his Chief of Staff, Eileen Banker. And representing the town of Sweden is its Supervisor, Rob Karges. Please give them a round of applause. Thank you, Dr. Marshall Lishman from the SUNY Board of Trustees for being here. He's no stranger to Brockport. He's presided over a number of, participated in a number of ceremonies that we've had here, not including several graduations. He's a great friend of the college. We're delighted to have him here today to do the same on this very special occasion. Dr. Lishman.
Thank you, Scott. Good afternoon. It's a particular pleasure to offer the well wishes of the State University of New York Board of Trustees to Heidi Macpherson on her installation as the president of this outstanding college. I believe that the best job, the most gratifying job in the academy, is that of president of an ideally sized college, large enough to do special things and small enough to provide intimacy and focused on the arts and sciences. President Macpherson's academic and administrative accomplishments and experiences predict, in my view, that she will be a visionary and thereby a transformative leader for the school and for the community. She brings to this college and to SUNY a remarkable duality, having been educated both in the United States and in the United Kingdom, and having served as a professor and academic administrator in both cultures. I'm reminded of President John F. Kennedy's remark when he received an honorary degree from Yale University, commenting that now he had the best of both worlds, a Harvard education and a Yale degree. SUNY finds itself in a similar position. In President Macpherson, we have a gifted academician who is president of an American college and speaks the Queen's English. We are fortunate indeed to have President Macpherson join the SUNY family. She will lead this fine school to loftier heights. All 64 SUNY schools are worthy of accolades. Each has a special character and does special things for its students. I confess to having had a particular relationship with SUNY Brockport, in part because of geographical proximity to my home. When I became a trustee, I was quickly embraced by then President John Halstead. I learned about its academic and extracurricular strengths from my visits here and of his devotion to leaving this a better school than he found it. It's a college admirably suited to turn high school graduates into educated citizens, prepared to make a contribution to our world with enthusiasm and vigor. The board has unbridled confidence that President Macpherson will provide the leadership the school deserves and needs. She also has the good fortune to have our gifted faculty, our committed and competent staff, our loyal alumni, and friends of the college at her side. She will be motivated in addition by the students that come to Brockport to learn and engage. So I offer all my good wishes and those of my colleagues to President Macpherson for a long tenure marked by innovation, accomplishment, and personal satisfaction. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Lishman. We are pleased to have you with us today, and we also have representatives from 22 colleges and universities here to partake in today's celebration. We warmly welcome all of you to Brockport. In addition, representatives from several organizations and governmental bodies are here to offer greetings to Dr. Macpherson. Our first greeter will be representing the officer of New York State Governor Andrew Cuomo. She is the Honorable Kathy Hochul, the Lieutenant Governor of the State of New York. Lieutenant Governor.
Good afternoon, everyone. What a spectacular celebration that's just beginning, but there's no place in the state of New York I'd rather be than right here, right now. On behalf of our governor, I am delighted to participate in this very special ceremony. I also want to recognize some of my colleagues in government. We are joined by our Senator Joe Robach. Good to see you, Joe. Also our County Executive Cheryl DeNolfo, our Mayor Lovely Warren, and of course our great leader from the SUNY system, our SUNY's first female chancellor, who's a true leader, leaving her mark every single day, and our paths crisscross constantly in the state of New York. But Nancy Zimfer, it is such an honor to be on the stage with you again here today. I also wanted, just before I get started my remarks about the president, thank the people of the Brockport community for opening your hearts to me as you did when I was so proud to represent this area as a member of Congress. I came here often with the president's predecessor. I came to visit the Veterans Center. We came in my capacity as Lieutenant Governor to do a State of the State address. We've also talked about the Rochester Anti-Poverty Initiative. So many times Brockport became the epicenter of important dialogues and conversations that affect this community and this state. So thank you so much for that. I'm also delighted to see the incredible growth on this campus just in a short time. The Department of Nursing new home and liberal arts building and the North Campus revitalization, which is going to be a profound impact on this community, a $12 million project. I actually asked one of your graduates who works for the governor, actually as of until this past week, Lauren Kelly. Lauren, I know you're out there. I said, tell me what it's like to be at Brockport. Tell me something that I should be able to say based on your experience as a graduate. And she said, it's a very special place. It's so hard to put into words, but it's a really special place. Well, Lauren, I think those words say it all. There is something really special about the community of Brockport, and I've been so impressed with the mission of Brockport, how you are taking so seriously the charge of not just educating individuals, but sending them out well-prepared into the economy of our state and preparing them for the jobs that are finally coming back to upstate New York under Governor Cuomo. Your learning living communities are harnessing creative juices, clustering students who have similar interests so they can have creative collisions and come up with new ideas and opportunities for when they graduate, teaching them life skills that they're going to so desperately need when they leave here. I could go on and on about the Brockport community, and I certainly will at another occasion, but today we celebrate our great fortune in having Heidi Macpherson as our president. You've already shown yourselves, President Macpherson, to be a leader in the Great Lakes area. In fact, you're in a very elite club of college presidents at all, and even smaller one of women presidents. But I hope when you come to the Finger Lakes, you feel a little more of the sisterhood, given that there are four presidents of colleges in this region who are represented by women. So that's very unique. I don't know what the experience like in England or in Wisconsin or other places, but in New York State, we believe in strong female leadership from Nancy Zimfer on down, and she's had a major impact on increasing the number of SUNY presidents who are women. We're at about 23 out of 64, up by 10 under Nancy Zimfer's leadership. So you're still actually in good company in New York, but unfortunately rare company across the nation. In fact, only 26% of presidents of colleges across America are women. And I actually did some quick math, even though it's not my strongest suit. It'll take 48 years at the rate we're going to have parity, half men and half women. So we'd like to think we're a little ahead of the curve here in New York, and I give credit to Brockport for its vision, not just selecting the most qualified individual, but someone who also happens to be a woman. I also want to say I was impressed as I was reading up on the ideas that our new president has, and she referenced the Sheryl Sandberg book, Lean In, which is really a way to talk to young women about taking their place in the world. And she talked about how women need to take their seats at the table. I have realized that you've done just that, President Macpherson. You've earned your seat at the table. In fact, you're at the head of the table. You are the leader of this campus, and that is very, very huge undertaking. We're very proud of that. Also, in preparation for today, I just gave a little bit of thought to what the role of a college president actually is. And I turned to an article from the Chronicle of Higher Education about an article on this, and you might appreciate the title that was written by two presidents entitled Bruised, Battered, and Loving It. So that may reflect what you've experienced in your last 9 months, I'm not so sure, but here's what they said, and I think you'd agree. The college presidency is a job of a lifetime, for reasons well beyond the perks and privileges. We get to create and sustain campuses where the learning and maturation of young people is paramount, where great teaching and path-breaking research can occur. But what drives us is a chance to do something meaningful and helpful to our students, faculty, staff, but even for society and the world. So President Macpherson, I encourage you to use this platform, this position of honor in which you've been entrusted to inspire not just excellence among the faculty, students, and staff, but to expand the voice of Brockport beyond the perimeters of this campus into the greater Rochester area, into the Finger Lakes, into the state, and indeed in the world. So we are so looking forward to your leadership, your guidance as you expand this influence. And on behalf of the governor, I want to thank you for including me in this celebration, and we wish you the very best on behalf of the people of the state of New York. Thank you.
Thank you, Lieutenant Governor. Next, I would like to introduce this academic year's President of Brockport Student Government, Mr. Sean Flynn. Sean?
Good afternoon, fellow students, faculty and staff, friends of the college, and honored guests. I'm Sean Flynn, President of the Brockport Student Government. And it's an honor for me to be here and take part in this installation of the College of Brockport's 7th president, Dr. Heidi Macpherson. Sophomore year, I took a class with Dr. Andrea Rubri, American Politics, And in that class, we reviewed many of the different personalities of the founding fathers of our nation. And she really tried to describe to us how influential the personas of the founding fathers were in the construction of our nation. This conglomerate of people was the first to create a nation through discussion, not conquest. And therefore, the way in which they worked as a team was imperative to their process. And one thing Dr. Rubery wanted to know when we were getting into this unit was how much we as a class knew about the topic. So she posed a question to us. She asked us, of all the founding fathers who took part in the Constitutional Convention, which one of them was the most feared public speaker? Which one of them was the most terrifying to have to argue against? And of course, you know, we shout out answers, you know. Well, it must have been John Adams, you know, he had such authority. Or Jefferson. Oh, well, Washington, he was so respected. And she just looked at us and she says, no, none of them. You know who was the worst to debate? Was James Madison. Quiet, timid, tiny James Madison was the worst to debate against, by far, she described. The reason being was that if you tried to outshine his argument in the debate by grandstanding and loudly denouncing some loophole in his argument, he would simply listen to you, stress the importance of your point, and then recite, by memory, 15 counterpoints to your own argument. It was useless to argue a case against him because he was so extraordinarily thorough in his research on the topic at hand. He would simply have more input than you would. And this is what I see in Dr. Macpherson. When Dr. Macpherson speaks, when she outlines a plan, when she works with a team, she has respect because she relies so intensely on the input of others. Her argument is strong and thoughtful. She's extraordinarily conscientious. She takes in all perspectives before she speaks. Watch her when she makes a speech. Watch her. She won't refer to herself. She'll refer to the evidence. She'll refer to what she knows, what she's listened to, and the people she's talked to. Never her own merit, never her own accord. This is one day where we get to celebrate someone who never celebrates themselves, who will always describe a success as a team effort. And that is why I'm so happy and so honored to celebrate Dr. Macpherson with you. She truly cares for each and every person in this room. And for that, we owe her a great deal. Dr. Macpherson, I am sure that everyone involved will benefit from what you bring to our campus. On behalf of more than 8,000 students, I would like to congratulate you as being chosen as our president, and I wish you success and good fortune during your time here. Thank you.
Thank you, Sean. Now it's my duty to introduce the president of the Brockport College Senate, Dr. Allison Parker. Dr. Parker has served as a member of the College Council for the last year. We were delighted to have her, and I'm looking forward to her remarks. Allison?
Good afternoon. I am honored to participate in the inauguration of our new president, Dr. Heidi Macpherson, at the College at Brockport. On behalf of the faculty and staff, I can sincerely say that we are thrilled to be building a better Brockport together. The College Senate represents and facilitates the value of shared governance. This has been an exciting year for us, as we on the faculty and staff have been collaborating with President Macpherson and Brockport students to take on a range of issues, including one that I'll highlight today: our commitment to anti-racism and diversity initiatives in order to build a more inclusive and accepting college campus. We all, students, faculty, staff, and administration, are being invited to learn to unlearn our biases, as well as to increase our intercultural competencies and understanding. If we can all treat each other more humanely, we will have accomplished much. We acknowledge that more work needs to be done at both the individual and institutional levels to achieve significant change, and we are committed to this effort. As a women's historian, I heartily celebrate the induction of our first female president at the college at Brockport. It is fitting that this week, President Macpherson and the Brockport community paid tribute to another key woman in the history of the college. As you may know, Fanny Barrier Williams was a native of Brockport who became the first African-American graduate of the Brockport Normal School in 1870. After her graduation, she became a leading civil rights and women's rights activist at the turn of the century. As part of this week's inaugural celebrations, the president helped unveil a beautiful memorial plaque in honor of Fanny Barrier Williams on the formal front entrance of Hartwell Hall. In an 1893 speech referring to recently emancipated black women, Williams proclaimed, quote, "One of the most wonderful things in human history is how eagerly these suddenly liberated women tried to lay hold upon all there is in human excellence. This constant striving for equality has given upward direction to all the activities of colored women," unquote. With our new president, we here at the College at Brockport today can similarly lay hold upon all there is in human excellence. This is our challenge and our opportunity, and we embrace it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Parker. Our next speaker, with greetings for Dr. Macpherson, is Joe Torrey. Joe is, I mentioned earlier, head of United University Professions. Dr. Torrey.
Friends, colleagues, esteemed guests, good afternoon and thank you for coming to this wonderful celebration. On behalf of organized labor, it is my distinct honor to welcome Heidi Macpherson to the college at Brockport and our broader academic community. When President Macpherson first accepted this position, I, along with everyone else in the liberal arts building, was simply ecstatic. That's where my office is. We were extremely happy. Her superb record of serious scholarship, her easy and collegial manner, and her tremendous achievements in administration impressed us deeply. And really, literally, there was a tremendous positive energy that day. It felt as if the entire liberal arts building was literally levitating a little bit. I was personally so excited, I went out and bought this tie. This is a Macpherson dress tartan, the modern dress tartan. When organized labor wears your tartan, there's happiness and prosperity in the land. Since that day, I've worked closely with her and her team, and I'm happy to report she continues to impress and to be awesome. She's intelligent, articulate, compassionate, witty, creative, professional, and she's kind, a rather underrated quality. She is, in short, presidential. She has, in her first year, already faced down a financial crisis of tremendous importance, and I might add that she did that with tremendous grace. She has infused her management team with a new vibrancy and a tremendous positive energy. LAB is levitating, but Allen Administration Building is amped up. In all her efforts and early achievements then, she has proved herself the real deal and in all ways an excellent choice in addition to our academic community. And the key to understanding this, I think, the key that she's become such a good fit for us, and we know she will continue to be a good fit into the future, is that she's one of us. She's a university professional dedicated to public higher education, maintaining a quality environment for all of our campus communities, and the broader philosophical principles like justice and equality, which underpin those ideas. On behalf of organized labor, I am extremely honored and excited to welcome into our community the latest addition to the English department, President Heidi Macpherson.
Thank you, Joe. And Heidi, by the way, that tie is not on display for the first time today. He's had it in meetings with you before. The Brockport Xylophone Percussion Ensemble was formed in 2008. is the first instrumental ensemble on campus in many years. It is unique in that it welcomes any student, regardless of instrumental background or training. Students and alumni contribute significantly by arranging or composing the ensemble's repertoire, which ranges from classical to contemporary. Today's piece, Outbound, is one of the group's favorite inspirational pieces. Thank you, Brockport Xylophone Ensemble. That was just great. Our next speaker with greetings for Dr. Macpherson is Maureen Casey, who's representing the Brockport Foundation Board. Maureen?
Thank you, Scott. Good afternoon, Lieutenant Governor, Chancellor Zimpfer, other distinguished guests, and most importantly, President Macpherson. I am deeply honored to be here today to represent Brockport's Foundation Board and its chair, Joe Duty, who regrets that he cannot be here today on this most momentous day. And as an alum, I am even prouder to officially welcome Brockport's first woman president. Those of us on the Foundation Board that have had the opportunity to work with you during your first 9 months, President Macpherson, are excited by what we see. The ease and passion of your embrace of not only the college's community, but also the communities of Brockport, Rochester, and the greater central and western New York regions has impressed us and inspired us. Your willingness to listen and learn, your intellect and your candor, confirm for us that we have the right person at the right time for this most important position. The relationship between the Foundation Board and the President is a critical one. We are aligned in our shared commitment to student success. And it has been evident since your arrival that you appreciate the importance of building this partnership, and that Foundation support will play a contributing role in helping you to accomplish the goals you set for our students, our faculty, staff, and college. Your immediate recognition that Brockport has great stories to tell and your willingness to tell them, to celebrate what makes us distinctive, is all music to a fundraiser's ears. We at the Foundation are eager to support you as you set the course for our college's continued success. I think I can say among this intimate gathering of friends that as a member of the Presidential Search Committee, there was something about you, President Macpherson, that intrigued and impressed a number of us from the very beginning. And through each step in the process, you did not disappoint, nor have you since joining the Brockport College team. I will say, however, that had we known from the outset that you count riding a unicycle among your many talents, you probably would have wrapped up the selection much sooner. To quote you, a focus on a greater Brockport, a greater Rochester, and a greater world is a great start. We are thrilled to be along for the ride and wish you and Alan nothing but the best. For your success will also mean success for our students, our college, and our community as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Maureen. I would now like to introduce the mayor of the Village of Brockport, who also happens to be a professor of anthropology emerita, Dr. Margay Blackman.
Thank you, Scott, and welcome, everyone. As an emerita professor of the college at Brockport, its administration, its faculty, students, and staff all occupy a special place in my life. As mayor of the Village of Brockport and on behalf of its residents, I am honored to be here this afternoon to welcome President Heidi Macpherson to the Brockport community. The remarkable thing about Dr. Macpherson is that she has already made her own welcome. Just as she and her husband Alan spent their first months living in a dorm, walking their dog Tilly on campus, and showing up regularly at the Cirque Fitness Center, so they became regulars on the streets of downtown Brockport. They had been here only a few days when they were spotted having lunch at Java Junction on Main Street. Village residents nodded. This was a very good sign. Within just a few weeks of their arrival, Heidi and Alan learned about the Erie Canal's recreational and tourism potential for the college and the community when they attended a local Canalway Recreation Way Plan workshop. Last fall, I joined Heidi on board the tugboat Syracuse when she eagerly signed on for the Canal Corporation's annual inspection tour of the Erie Canal, the artificial river, as one historian dubbed it, that Village and College share. When it came time to meet and greet members of the community, it was the office of the president that reached out to the village about where to host such a reception. Last September, Heidi and Alan greeted an enthusiastic crowd of citizens of the greater Brockport community at the center on State Street. I would be remiss if I did not give special mention in my welcome to the other half of this presidential partnership, Alan Macpherson, sometimes affectionately referred to by the president as the first dude. We eagerly recruited and quickly appointed Alan to the Village's Historic Preservation Board. Back in 1965, Village Mayor Frank Sicelli, Brockport alum of the class of 1945, in collaboration with SUNY Brockport President Al Brown, created the first Town Gown Committee to address college-community relations. In 2014, the Village and College revived this important committee. Heidi has been an active participant and supporter of its efforts and is soon to be its co-chair. Engagement and involvement with the host community of a college is a small part of a college president's job, but it is an important one that Heidi would be the first to acknowledge. Both college and village are better when we can find common ground, benefit from the advantages each offers, partner to solve mutual problems, and together plan for the future. There is no doubt in my mind that Heidi Macpherson will be a strong and willing partner during her presidency in this mutual endeavor. Welcome, Heidi and Alan, from the Village of Brockport. Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor Blackman. I would next like to welcome the Mayor of the City of Rochester, the Honorable Lovely Warren. Lovely?
Thank you, Scott. Good afternoon. I am so proud to join all of you here today to welcome Dr. Macpherson to the College at Brockport in the Rochester community. As the first female mayor of the City of Rochester, I am particularly honored to be here at the inauguration of the first female president of the College of Brockport. You are joining a community that values innovation, technology, knowledge, and entrepreneurship. From the flower mills to the flower beds, from the photographs to photonics, we have always been a city that has been ahead of the times. We have always been a city that leads. So many of our city successes began right here at the College of Brockport. And I know that under your leadership, the college will continue to produce the best and brightest minds to lead the way in Rochester. Brockport has continually been a gateway to higher education and a brighter future for many families in our city, not just here on the main campus, but at the downtown Metro Center and the Rochester Educational Opportunity Center, which partners with the city to help get our citizens trained and career ready. In fact, Brockport was the gateway to higher education for my family. It took a lot of willpower, tenacity, grit, and hard work. But in 1976, my Aunt Lovely became the first person in my family to put on a cap and gown and hold a college diploma. She did this right here on this very campus. My family was so proud that they even named the next girl in the family after her. Since my Aunt Lovely wore this regalia at Brockport in 1976, every child in my family has gone on to some sort of post-secondary education. So as you can tell, the impact that the College of Brockport has on our community is very personal to me. Through the years, the college has helped not just individuals, but entire families open doors and shatter barriers. Thanks to this college, we've been able to make our neighborhood safer and more vibrant and create new educational opportunities. So on behalf of the citizens of Rochester, I welcome you, Dr. Macpherson, and thank you for all that you will do and are about to do on behalf of the College of Brockport.
Thank you, Mayor Warren. Very inspiring remarks. I had no idea that Brockport had such an important role in your family, and I think the college at large is delighted that we've been able to do that for your family and so many other families over our history. Next, I would like to introduce the president of the Brockport Alumni Association, Mr. Warren Kozareski. Warren?
It's an amazing honor and privilege to represent the 90,000 alumni at the College of Brockport at this historic event, the inauguration of our seventh president. As graduates, we are ambassadors for this college. Whether we are 5, 10, 40, or more years away from our time as a student, we demonstrate to the world every day what it means to have spent several very special years here. As a Golden Eagle, I'm always amazed and proud to read about the accomplishments of our alumni throughout the state, the region, nation, and world. And very humbled to realize that it all started from one building over 180 years ago. As a first-generation college student, I've witnessed several transitions in our history. As an undergrad during the search and inauguration of our fourth president, Dr. John Van de Wettering, and a faculty staff member during the terms of our fifth and sixth presidents, Dr. Paul Yu and Dr. John Halstead. We have found a great fit for Brockport and Dr. Macpherson. In her short time here, she has traveled the country to learn about our history from our alumni while conducting a deep dive here on campus into what makes us tick in our corner of Western New York. The next chapter of the college history mirrors and converges with the next chapter of the Alumni Association's history. We're as excited as you are about the possibilities. Even as the college is poised for growth and change, so too is the Alumni Association on the cusp of a new phase in its evolution. On behalf of the Alumni Association, welcome Dr. Macpherson, and we're very much looking forward to working with you as you share with us all of your vision for the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Kais. At this time, I would like to introduce Dr. Steve Klepetar, who will speak on behalf of the academic community. Dr. Klepetar holds degrees from SUNY Binghamton, where he got his undergraduate and his master's degree, so he's part and parcel of the family of the SUNY system. He got his PhD from the University of Chicago. He currently is emeritus professor from St. Cloud State University in Minnesota, where, most importantly, he taught Heidi English and creative writing courses during her undergraduate days there. And by all accounts, and you may hear this from Heidi later, was her favorite professor, Dr. Klepetar.
Thank you so much. The most important lesson I learned from Heidi was that you should always be kind to your students because someday you might end up working for them. It's really an honor to speak for the academic community at Heidi Sledadahl Macpherson's installation as the president of the college at Brockport. I met Heidi when she was a sophomore student in one of my classes at St. Cloud State University, and I am so proud of what she has accomplished as a scholar, a teacher, an administrator. She has done herself, and if I may say so, St. Cloud State proud. Like Heidi, I thoroughly enjoyed my educational experiences at Binghamton and felt well prepared for PhD work at the University of Chicago. Heidi exemplifies the ways that excellent public education prepares students for great careers, and I'm so glad to have had the opportunity to work with her and to see her succeed so brilliantly. Here's the poem I wrote for this occasion. The title of the poem is Invisible Wings for Heidi Sledadahl Macpherson. And it begins with an epigraph from a poem by Anne Sexton called To a Friend Whose Work Has Come to Triumph. The epigraph goes like this. Admire her wings, feel the fire at her neck, and see how casually she glances up and is caught, wondrously tunneling into that hot eye. There's a certain gleam in the eyes that speaks, even at 19, of invisible wings folded calmly where roots of heart and mind conjoin. A sweet strength, intelligence coupled with will and energy, an openness to ideas and to places far from a small, well-loved place. She attends with ear and eye, tasting words, making them her own. Hail to the student who sees into the life of things, the professor who leaves with a laugh and a kind hand. Hail to the dean who understands. And when those glittering wings rustle, then open, nurtured by family and love, toughened by study, hard work, and the many joys of a busy life, she sails across oceans, bearing her burdens so lightly, they seem like many colored balls dancing in air, managed only by the magic of her skillful hands. Thank you.
Absolutely beautiful, Dr. Klepetar. Today would not have been possible without the hard work and dedication of our search committee, a wonderful search committee that labored from September 2014 until April 2015. With the members of the search committee who are here today, faculty, staff, college council members, foundation members, alumni association members, please stand and be recognized. I would also ask that Cindy Krautwurst, who provided invaluable administrative support to the search committee during those long months, also stand with the search committee. Please recognize our wonderful search committee. As important at the end of the process were the members of the College Council, whose obligation it was under state law to take the work of the search committee and make our recommendation to the chancellor. Would the College Council stand and be recognized, please? Yet, as important as the roles of the search committee and the College Council were in the process, none of this would have been possible without the exceptional candidate who emerged in January 2015. From the moment she finished her search committee interview at the Hyatt, and then from her first campus visit, we all knew that the person seated behind me to my right was the one. Thank you, Brockport, for giving us the opportunity to bring you such a terrific new president. We are delighted to have Chancellor Zimpfer here today to invest our new president. As we've heard before, Dr. Zimpfer is the first woman to serve as Chancellor of the State University of New York. Prior to her arrival in New York, she was president of the University of Cincinnati. Ohio's loss, our gain. Previously, she'd served as Chancellor of the University of Wisconsin-Milwaukee and a Dean and Professor of Education at The Ohio State University. She began her tenure at SUNY in the summer of 2009, and since then has done outstanding work in higher education involving SUNY's 64 campuses. It's my pleasure to present the Chancellor of the State University of New York, Dr. Nancy L. Zimpfer.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. I have to say that I am absolutely thrilled to be back home. I am no stranger to the College at Brockport. When I began my tenure as chancellor, I embarked on a 64 campus tour, probably the most naive decision I ever made. I had no idea how big the state could be and how distributed our campuses are within 15 miles of every New Yorker. That was indeed my first visit to this campus. I'm proud to say that I visited here on the dedication of this wonderful Cirque Center. I had the great privilege of witnessing how the College at Brockport celebrates diversity, equity, and inclusion. I came back later for Board of Trustee meetings, for student speakouts, and I am here today thrilled to assist in the inauguration of Dr. Heidi Macpherson. So let me recognize the distinguished elected officials who have come to witness this event, give a little shout out to the Lieutenant Governor. Kathy Hochul and I do hit the road together from time to time. We are now about visiting each of the governor's economic regions to celebrate community college council work. We'll be back here in the Rochester area soon. She is a great partner, and most recently, we together celebrated Women's History Month. All of you, participants, faculty, staff, students, alumni, friends of the College at Brockport, thank you for being here. This is a marvelous, marvelous crowd. I am here personally representing the Board of Trustees of the State University of New York, our Chairman Carl McCall, and of course I'm thrilled that Marshall Lichtman is here as well and shows such affection for this campus. There are SUNY presidents in the house, and I am always thrilled when our presidents come to witness such an event and stand beside our president. To Alan, the first dude, I think that's really cool. And to the family who assist you in this celebration, to our dear John and John, for your shoulders upon which Heidi Macpherson's work will stand. To everyone here who is celebrating this event, I want to start with a story because such emphasis has been given to the first woman. So campus presidents, and Heidi will be no exception, are often asked by students if they can shadow the president for a day. I have a technique. I give that student my busiest day. I want it full on, what a campus president or a chancellor does all day. So in the instance when I was a campus president, I had a shadowing student, and on that day, I was speaking to the downtown Rotary. Of course, my student who was shadowing had no transportation, so I took him to Rotary after we had had several morning meetings. He didn't pack a lunch, so happily, the Rotary fed him. He observed my introduction and my remarks, and of course, I've had a few firsts myself, and there are many on this platform, as you have heard. He said to me, "Don't you get tired of being introduced as the first woman, yada, yada, yada?" It was a question I had never thought I would need to answer. But I heard myself say, when it doesn't need to be said anymore, it won't. That's what it means. That's what it means today. So I think there should be at least one question on your mind, and that is, why do we need an inauguration? Why did we wait 9 months to have this ceremony? What does it mean to the leadership of President Macpherson? And I will say there are many decisions in this occasion that are left to the president and to the college council and to other members of the community. But the decision to have this inaugural 9 months after President Macpherson arrived on this campus was one of great wisdom, because now you will hear her speak, as has been referenced, not of her own mind, but of all the wisdom that you have shared through vision cafes, which I think is a wonderful idea, through a budget and financial planning task force, to her tours around the departments and the schools. What she says today, after 9 months of getting acquainted with the Brockport community, will be your words, and I dare say she will say our words. So that's why an inaugural occurs a little bit after you first arrive on a campus. And before I briefly describe the place of Brockport in the State University of New York, I want to say to you, of all the people here to witness the ceremony, from faculty, staff, students, and alumni, distinguished guest, there is one person thrilled above all else, and while he thanked others, let us thank the chair of the College Council at the College of Brockport, Scott Turner. Scott, thank you so very much. Tremendous hard work. So we are in an amazing transformation at the State University of New York. It began, I would say, almost 8 years ago, when we determined that our vision for the State University of New York, the power of SUNY, would be to so invest in the state of New York that we would, at that time of the Great Recession, lift this state up in both its economic and cultural development. And underneath the power of SUNY were six big ideas that are still alive today in healthcare, in energy, in innovation, in serving our vibrant communities. But one stands above all, that we would contribute to sealing the leaks in the education pipeline. Now, that's terminology that 8 years ago, not too many people were talking about. But today, we openly acknowledge that we need a more educated citizenry. President Obama, the Lumina Foundation, the Gates Foundation, all have set very ambitious goals to get more youth and adults educated to 2- and 4-year degrees. Today we talk about micro-credentials, to get them to badges, to certificates. And so, as good as the State University of New York is today, and we're good, we extend 93,000 degrees to New Yorkers every year. But you know what we've said to ourselves? We're good, but we are not good enough when only 46% of the New York adult population has a post-secondary degree, and when only 1 in 5 high school students will make it to that baccalaureate degree in 6 years or a 2-year degree in 3. That is unacceptable to us, so we have set our sights on moving from 93,000 degrees to 150,000 degrees a year, maybe by 2020, but frankly, as soon as we can get there. And I'll tell you what, we need the leadership of the college at Brockport. We need you to extend the access to this wonderful college, to work faithfully with our community colleges, to capture the transfer students who seek the baccalaureate degree, to work with adults, to retrain the workforce, to help us build that number. And that's why I am especially proud that we have a president at the College of Brockport who gets this challenge. And we know that you, together, will contribute to this ambitious goal. That said, we should get on with the show. I would like to bring to my right President Heidi Macpherson. Are you ready? Dr. Heidi Macpherson, you have the most important privilege and responsibility of leading the State University of New York's College at Brockport, established in 1867 to the fulfillment of its great promise as one of the premier comprehensive campuses in the SUNY system and an integral partner to the region and the state. As Chief Executive Officer, you are assigned all the powers, duties, and responsibilities appropriate to the post. The Board of Trustees and I are confident that under your leadership, this institution, pursuing the highest traditions of teaching, scholarship, and public service, will continue its dedication to the great state of New York, the nation, and the world. By virtue of the power vested in me by the Board of Trustees of the State University of New York, I now present you, Friends of the College, the 7th President of the State University of New York, College at Brockport, Heidi Macpherson. All right.
At this time, I would like to call your attention to the stage as we offer a celebratory performance to commemorate Heidi's installation as the 7th president of the College of Brockport. College learning explores the external world of nature, of human society, and of professional training. But serious learning of any kind is also intensely personal. It is a risk-taking process. It is a matter of finding your own voice and expressing it creatively. Rooted in the traditions of Ghana, Sankofa is a symbolic expression represented by a bird whose head turns back looking towards the past. The Sankofa African dance and drum ensemble retrieves the cultural essences of the past and brings them to our celebration today. Many of us in the Brockport community have experienced the energy and art of Sankofa before. Indeed, much of the nation has shared in the experience of hearing Sankofa. This is your first opportunity. You are in for a treat. Please welcome Sankofa.
Wasn't that wonderful? So much energy in the room. I'm not sure I've seen so much energy in one place so quickly. And now you get to listen to a speech. Thank you so much for being here. I'm so honored and delighted to see you here and to share in this wonderful event. With both community and gratitude as the touchstones of this speech, it is only right and fair that I begin today with thanks. Thank you so much for being here to help celebrate the college at Brockport and our academic community. I particularly want to thank SUNY Chancellor Nancy Zimpfer, the SUNY Board of Trustees, the College Council, and the Search Committee for the faith that they placed in me. It is truly a privilege to work in higher education. I also want to thank the distinguished members of the Platform Party, the delegates representing our sister schools, our faculty, staff, students, our emeriti, our distinguished professors and alumni, my academic and professional colleagues from around the country, my family and friends who have come out in force and in strength to be here, thank you, along with our community members, our legislators, and all the other friends of Brockport who have gathered here today. Thank you. To my wonderful and very favorite professor, Dr. Klepetar, from whom you heard earlier, thank you for teaching me to write and for believing in my ability to do so and for being here to share this moment with me. In honoring our past and planning for our future, I also want to recognize our former presidents in attendance today, John Vander Wettering and John Halstead, for the service you offered to our great institution. Thank you. Today, I want to highlight Brockport's commitment to community and thank the Inauguration Committee, who worked so hard to ensure that this week of activities was a fitting tribute to the history of our college and what we hold dear. President Tower, in his installation speech, outlined the need to move from self-sufficiency and isolation to an understanding of global interdependency, a sentiment that holds as true today as it did in 1944. Our Brockport community is vast and varied, from former principals and presidents to significant women of Brockport, honored and highlighted, from Fanny Berrier Williams, the first African-American graduate of Brockport back in 1870, to our own Margie Blackman, Brockport's mayor, who serves our community so well. I am proud to be the first woman president of the college, but many women have paved the way before me, and we owe them a tremendous debt of gratitude. Indeed, we have a series of paving stones, as well as buildings, named after the women of Brockport, and it was my honor to learn more about them from our archivist, Charlie Cowling. Charlie wrote to me that a school like ours has a quite admirable history of opportunity for women, as students and professors. Long before women could attend or teach at many private Ivy League schools, they were studying and teaching at academies and normal schools like we once were. I learned that Edwards Hall was named in part for Alida Edwards, chair of the English department from 1908 to 1934. She was a Brockport alum who undertook advanced work towards her doctorate at the University of Wisconsin, as well as Cambridge University, England. Her transatlantic connections, her Midwestern education, and her subject, English, make me believe we might have had some things in common. Ronald Heifetz, founding director of the Center for Public Leadership at Harvard, claimed in a recent speech to college presidents, "To make a good diagnosis, you must first take a history." It is certainly true that to understand our wonderful college, we must pay tribute to those who have gone before and who have done the hard work of diversifying our community, whether they were aware that they were groundbreaking individuals or not. Five women have paving stones named after them, including Fanny Berrier Williams, honored earlier this week with a plaque unveiled at Hartwell Hall. She was a nationally known public speaker, writer, and activist for civil and gender rights. Mary Jane Holmes was a successful novelist and a keen supporter of the college, and Holmes Hall is, in part, named after her. Pauline Haynes was a music instructor and the first chair of the music department, who lends her name to a room in the alumni house.
Ruth Drake was a kindergarten instructor and campus school librarian for over 30 years, and our current library is, in part, named after her. Alice Yale was an art teacher here at Brockport who was a respected, loved, and colorful personality, and that description alone makes me wish I had known her. Briggs, Mortimer, Neff, now part of Lathrop Hall, and Vanderhoof, now part of Morgan Hall, were all named after women who were important both to the college and to the wider Brockport community. I honor these women leaders because they had many more barriers to overcome to success than most women leaders these days. I myself have been blessed with mentors who have seen in me more than I saw in myself and who've urged me and indeed pushed me to find that person. They have taught me by example to reach out to others and to look for talent to nurture, because surely that is our highest calling and the best way we have to give back to our community. And although you can't be here today, I know that at least some of you are watching on the live stream. So Philip, David, Janice, Janet, John, and Daniel, thank you all for all that you did to ensure that I am standing here today. And of course, I must also say hello to Jason Isaacs. I was fortunate while in the UK to be selected for a year-long program of learning with top civil servants, managers in the National Health Service, the Fire Service, the Police Service, and a few educationalists like me. Together, we learned a lot about different kinds of leadership, and I'm proud to see where my community of colleagues have ended up, leading major organizations like the UK Passport Office and other areas. As part of that program, we had a week in South Africa, learning about leadership there. We visited entrepreneurs and local officials. Some of us visited an HIV/AIDS clinic, and most of us visited schools. I learned a significant lesson in leadership when I went to a school in the township of Soweto. The school was behind a barbed wire fence. Our young hosts served us Coke and chips and asked us if we had those items where we came from too. Their sense of place was different from ours. We asked them about the barbed wire fence, and I learned a lot about leadership in their answer. "We did that," they said, with shining eyes and wide smiles. "We wanted that fence, and we got it. We wanted to be safe at school, and now we are. Now we can learn." They raised money for a fence so they could be free of fear, of drug dealing, and of crime. They were proud of their fence because it was a visible reminder of their promise and their success to come. They reminded me that leadership comes at all levels, from all those who are prepared to make a difference and to take responsibility for making change happen. They certainly taught me to review with a different lens something my cultural frame was framing wrongly. As Stephanie Bauer recently wrote in the Chronicle of Higher Education, "One of the most valuable components of a liberal arts education is the ability to encounter experiences beyond our own that simultaneously shrink and expand our sense of the world." We also visited a maximum security prison. We met 25 men who sat with us and told us their stories. Most of the stories were of how they ended up in prison, and none of those stories were nice. And all of them, I'm sure, were partial. One man admitted that his sentence was 300 years. 300 years. Later that day, we would leave the prison, but he never would. And yet, that man talked to us of his gratitude. Those 25 men had a leader who recognized something in them to nurture, and who led them to a place where gratitude was at the center of their day. Each had a gratitude stone. At the end of the night, they held the stone and recounted all the things for which they were grateful. The men in the room did not alter their sentences by becoming part of the group that practiced gratitude, so there was no exterior motivation for doing so. But even in the most difficult circumstances, they chose to be part of a community that decided to take charge of how they responded to those circumstances. An egalitarian leadership was practiced as each man received time to speak and to connect, and as each then as each one then passed a talking stick to someone else to share. At the end of our time with them, they passed out gratitude stones to us. And I knew that who I was as a leader could be transformed through gratitude too. I still have that stone. I have more than one. Today, I am grateful to Mark Knoll and to his students who went to a glacial deposit near the southern shoreline of Lake Ontario and gathered over 700 stones and brought them back to campus. They polished them and put them into bags. They are the college's parting gift to you, an individual gratitude stone to help sustain our community and to strengthen it. These stones represent so much more to me than gratitude, though I hope gratitude will remain at the heart of what we achieve. The stones originated in Canada and so symbolize our international connections, which are of particular interest to me given my lifelong commitment to international education. I have benefited from it tremendously. Indeed, my life was utterly transformed by my international experiences. And we have, as a college, just signed up to the Institute of International Education's Generation Study Abroad program, designed to double the number of students in the U.S. who study abroad. The stones were gathered through a service learning and undergraduate research opportunity, which shows our commitment to our community of students who learn best when we actively participate in their lives and education. Experiential learning has been part of Brockport since it began as a teacher training college. Moreover, it is a pillar of the new strategic plan that we are undertaking this year. And these rocks are a way of connecting our community to you. Heifetz argues that we must learn from and encourage the leadership that's being practiced every day by people without authority. I believe that my position as president should be one of service, but I also know that I have a position of great authority. I recognize, though, that leadership doesn't reside in the seventh floor of the Allen Administration Building. It is practiced every day by the person on campus who sees a visitor looking at a campus map and asks them if they can help guide them to where they want to go. It resides in the career counselors who help students work through their strengths and areas of interest. It is in the coaches who make sure that our students are not just All-American, but academic All-Americans, with strong GPAs as well as athletic prowess. It is in the professors who transform the lives of the students they teach by pushing them to go beyond easy answers and comfortable positions to positions of discomfort and intellectual growth. I am grateful to everyone who willingly becomes part of this wider community and who works to ensure the success of our students. I've spent the last 9 months listening as people have talked to me about the things that we should focus on as an institution to ensure that we achieve our objectives. We have, I'm pleased to say, completed the work on our Fund the Future project, which engaged a large group of people in the task of right-sizing our budget. Budget management is never very exciting work, but it was truly necessary, and I'm grateful to our colleagues for their diligent and sometimes provocative conversations on our priorities. This was a necessary first step in helping us launch our new strategic planning process. This work is ongoing, but again, a committed group of individuals is helping to define who we are and who we want to be. And I can share with you that the things that have historically made us Brockport are still key to our future. Our focus on student engagement, our commitment to the wider community, our desire to make our transformative research of benefit to the public. Education is a public good, and our community is the world. I firmly believe in a greater Brockport for a greater Rochester, and a greater Brockport for a greater world. As a college, we are building our strategic plan around four pillars: community, engagement, excellence, and transformation. And I can't wait to see the results of our collective efforts. Our academic community is the strongest and most fragile of our communities. It expands beyond the borders of our campus master plan and even across oceans. My own academic community is international in scope, despite its contestable title, American Studies. In fact, American Studies is a community I didn't know existed until I left the shores of the United States. And I'm grateful to my erudite American Studies colleagues for being part of my intellectual life. Our community is strengthened by trust and academic freedom, and weakened by distrust and threats around funding. At its best, it is a community that offers nurture and respect, communication and care, and it is at its best when we care for it, when we actively choose to be part of something larger than ourselves, when we offer our service and our collective energies to sustain it. This last year, we reissued our Better Community Statement, and we're using it with incoming first-year and transfer students, at departmental meetings, and elsewhere. And I would urge you to look it up if you are a visitor to campus. We promise many things in this statement, only a few of which I'll mention here, but they are things that resonate with me as we move forward on our strategic plan. The statement begins, "As members of the State University of New York College at Brockport, we choose to be part of an academic community that is dedicated to principles that foster integrity, civility, and justice. As citizens of a broad and pluralistic society, we encourage all those of all cultures, orientations, and backgrounds to educate, understand, and respect one another in a safe environment." The statement notes that we realize our common interests exceed our individual differences, and that we affirm the well-being of our individual groups, units, organizations, or disciplines cannot be separated from the overall college community. Moreover, as members of this college community, we strive for academic and personal excellence that will enable us to achieve lives of productive work, personal enrichment, and useful citizenship in an increasingly interdependent world. Academic leadership requires a willing community and a shared goal. And I know that as we continue to focus as a campus on our new plans, we will keep community at the center of what we do. Internally, we have created NEST, a new employee support training opportunity, as well as an internal promotion policy that helps our community strengthen itself. Externally, we continue to work in partnership with others. This year alone, the campus has launched a new Institute for Poverty Studies and Economic Development and continued through the REOC to be a strong member of the Rochester-Monroe County Anti-Poverty Task Force. We have strengthened our relationships with local and area schools, continuing to support, for example, the Summer Leap Program for students from School 17 to help reduce summer learning loss. We continue to partner with Camp Good Days and Special Times, and this year, we've also made a commitment to Rochester Rotary's Sunshine Camp. We have created a new partnership with Top Capital in relation to a senior living complex in Sweden that will offer our students opportunities for service learning and encourage our local seniors to make this college their own. We launched a new Flying Start, Flying Finish donor program to help students achieve success in their chosen paths and to help them with financial support as they near the end of their work with us. We have supplemented the funds we offer for undergraduate research opportunities and are now actively soliciting support for this important high-impact practice. By 2022, we will have doubled the number of summer research awards we give out. This work helps our students remain part of our academic community and eventually go on to help support others as they have been supported. And on the theme of community, it is worth remembering that the college has had a long and important, even symbiotic, relationship with the Village community. Over the years, and on several separate occasions, the Village community and prominent citizens have been staunch advocates for and provided significant support to ensure that the college survived through both political and financial threats to its future. It's fair to say that the college would not be here had that support not been forthcoming. Today, the college has a very large footprint in the community, and it is through working together that we can ensure that this relationship remains a positive one. I would like to strengthen our links through town and gown initiatives, and I believe we can continue to be a positive influence through the work of our students, faculty, and staff in outreach, research, education, and recreation. We have a significant role to play in supporting the regeneration of Brockport and the wider Rochester area. It is through initiatives in partnership that this can be achieved. Given this emphasis on partnership, I want to share one last story of my leadership journey. I was privileged to attend SUNYCon 2015 and to be part of a small group of individuals who were given a masterclass in improvisation by the actor and now SUNY professor, Alan Alda. Alda stressed to us that you cannot have innovation without communication. At one point, he put us into random pairs and asked us to do a mirroring exercise. The brief was clear. In pairs, make your partnership so close that the audience cannot tell who's leading and who's following. At the end of our first practice session, my partner and I were called to demonstrate and told to switch roles. My partner would now be the follower, and I would be the leader, despite having practiced the other way around. It turns out that my follower wasn't a very good follower. He was, I have to say, always at least half a beat behind. There was, I will admit, a certain frustration on my part. At the end of the exercise, the whole group knew that I was the leader. His lack of attention made that obvious. Except, of course, it didn't. What made it obvious to everyone was that I was not attentive enough to my partner. I moved too quickly. I expected him to read my mind. It was my communication style that was at fault. What a hard and crucial lesson to learn. It is easy to be seduced into thinking you are right, and difficult but vital to look for other perspectives. I tell you that story because it was hard feedback to get. After all, one of my heroes, Alan Alda from MASH, pointed out my mistakes to everyone in the room. And now I point them out to you because I want to be open to feedback. I want us all to strive to communicate better, to work in partnership, and to receive feedback not with humiliation, but with humility. Our academic community is stronger if we do these things together, and I will commit to continue to try to invite and to receive with wisdom the feedback that you offer me. I can report there was a happy ending. My partner and I got better at the exercise. By the end, we were pretty good at it. And Alan Alda posed for a photograph with me, which I tweeted, so it all turned out all right. I want to close on some words by a Brockport community member, a woman who passed away at the end of 2015, Frances Moroni Whited. Fran was an emerita professor and one of our college's greatest supporters, and she was never happier than when introducing us to one of her mentees or her scholarship winners. Although I only met her a few times, I was struck by her energy and her community spirit. Fran is reported to have used this phrase as her guiding principle. You can influence many lives. Do your best. To Fran, and to all my colleagues, I want to thank you for the life and leadership lessons you have offered. And perhaps I like Fran's the best. You can influence many lives. Do your best. Thank you.
Wow. What a great inaugural speech, Heidi. This concludes the formal portion of the installation ceremony. Please remain in your seats until the processional is complete. Everyone is now invited to join us for a reception immediately behind the screen. Thank you for coming today and for supporting President Heidi Macpherson and the College of Brockport. I now declare this ceremony to be concluded. Thank you.
people have left. Yeah.